IRS, UIL, NISD, and campus policy compliance. IRS compliance. Compliance with the annual tax reporting requirements have already been discussed, but there are other areas where the IRS governs the operations of a 501c3 tax-exempt organization. Cooperative fundraising and individual fundraising accounts, or IFAs. The PBUSA website contains a thorough explanation as follows. Cooperative fundraising is when a group's members join together cooperatively to raise money and then credit the funds raised or the time spent volunteering to the individuals who participated in raising the money. The accounts credited are known as individual fundraising accounts. These types of activities, while common among booster clubs, are not considered a 501c3 tax-exempt activity. Tax-exempt 501c3 organizations must be operated for a public purpose. Booster clubs, for example, often operate for public purposes such as supporting amateur athletics, supporting arts in the schools, community support for public education, and the like. The IRS and tax court have both found that cooperative fundraising activities are operated for the private benefit of the individual members of the group involved in the fundraising. This type of cooperative fundraising may be engaged in by a for-profit, tax-paying organization, but not by a nonprofit, tax-exempt 501c3 group. If cooperative fundraising comprises any significant part of your group's total activities, think more than 5% of total funds raised are credited to the individual accounts of parents, students participating in the fundraising, although the IRS does not have a specific percentage test, then your group likely would not be considered to qualify for 501c3 status by the IRS. PBUSA highly recommends avoiding the use of cooperative fundraising or individual fundraising accounts entirely. The first portion of the PBUSA's official IFA policy reads as follows. The IRS has found that the use of IFAs frequently results in illegal private benefit. However, the IRS has stopped short of strictly prohibiting IFAs. Based on the available IRS guidelines, PBUSA adopts the following policy regarding its members' use of IFAs. A. PBUSA strongly encourages its members not to use IFAs. B. If PBUSA members use IFAs, the IFA activity must make up an insubstantial portion of the overall activities of the organization, and participation in fundraising and or IFA activity must be voluntary. C. PBUSA members who engage in IFA activity do so at their own risk, understanding that IFAs may result in fines and penalties from the IRS and or loss of tax-exempt status. If the IRS finds that IFAs are used by your club, it will request evidence that an exception applies. In such a case, the booster club bears the burden of proof to establish that it is not organized or operated for the benefit of private interests related to the creation of individual accounts within the unit. If that burden of proof is not met, the IRS may determine that the club's IFAs are not a primary activity to accomplish one or more of their exempt purposes, and revoke the club's 501c3 tax-exempt status. Donations and appropriating funds. It is important to remember that all funds donated or otherwise received by any 501c3 organization must be used at the discretion of the organization in a manner that furthers its tax-exempt purpose. Funds must also be used to benefit the general public, for example, banned academic or athletic programs, and not any individuals specifically. Donors, whether individuals, groups, or businesses, also may not request that their donated funds be allocated for any specific purpose. Also, donations are only tax deductible for the donor if they do not receive anything of value in return. In a case where a person pays more than the face or fair market value of a particular item, product, or service, the person may claim a deduction for the difference. UIL Booster Club Guidelines. From page 1 of the UIL Booster Club Guidelines. The district superintendent is solely responsible for the entire UIL program. All school activities, organizations, including the booster clubs, events, and personnel are under the jurisdiction of the superintendent. Booster clubs must recognize this authority and work within a framework prescribed by the school administration. The UIL Booster Guidelines brochure is available on the UIL website and summarizes the do's and don'ts of athletic, academic, and music booster clubs operating in the state of Texas. The guidelines also express the importance of communication and cooperation between booster clubs, the school district, and the school campus. They also outline some basic points relating to fiscal responsibility and the importance of always putting the education of the students first, ensuring that good sportsmanship and the spirit of competition is always respected and trusted, and adhering to ethical practices along the way. It is also important to note the cooperative fundraising and IFA activity could subject your band or athletic group to disqualification in competitions that are governed by UIL. NISD policies and NBA bylaws. There are no extensive guidelines or policies governing booster clubs because the UIL guidelines are already in force. However, the NISD does require that all volunteers complete background checks before being allowed to participate in events where students are present. The most effective way of ensuring that booster members have completed the required background check is having them purchase an NISD photo identification badge from their school. The school administration can provide confirmation that each volunteer passed their background check. Once confirmation is made, volunteers can have their picture taken and printed on a badge bearing the words Band Booster or Athletic Booster. This indicates to all NISD personnel that the volunteer has been cleared and is authorized to access certain areas of NISD facilities. The NISD also operates the Northside Booster Administration, or NBA, to manage concessions at various athletics facilities throughout the district, including the Don Hardin Athletic Complex, Dub Ferris Athletic Complex, Northside Swim Center, and O'Connor High School Gym. The NBA's bylaws are posted on the NISD website and set forth the rules and regulations pertaining to concession staff by NISD booster clubs, including mandatory meetings, scheduling assignments, enforcing fees, and distribution of funds to booster clubs. Campus Administration POC. Each school has its own policies, written or otherwise, for working with booster clubs. Schools may impose an approval process for fundraisers held on campus, require security and or janitorial staff to be present at events held on campus, take disciplinary actions against booster members found to be in violation of any government UIL or district policy or ethical standards, or even mediate booster-related issues. Booster clubs need to make sure they are in constant communication with their school administration's point of contact assigned to oversee their activities. A supportive school administration can provide a level of authority that an independent club simply does not have. Failure to comply with the previously stated policies may result in a wide range of consequences, including but not limited to IRS fines, revocation of your club's tax-exempt status on the federal or state level, disqualification of your school in music and athletic events, or even the possibility of legal action against your booster club.